Hey folks, Jeremy Rigged here. Today we're working on a 2002 Chevy Tahoe with a failing fuel pump. Traditionally, you would drop the fuel tank to replace the fuel pump, and I have no interest in dropping the fuel tank. This truck has over 200,000 miles on it. It's 20 years old. There's a lot of inherent other risks with dropping the fuel tank that I'd rather not encounter. I just want to get the vehicle back on the road. So this isn't the way the mechanics will do it. But this is the way that you can do it and save yourself a lot of money and a lot of time. So we're going to make an access port in the floorboards underneath the driver's side rear seat. I'll get all this marked out on the floor for you, show you how to do it. Start to finish, it takes about an hour. So I called some of the better mechanics in town and they wanted between $700 and $900 to do this job. So to me, it's just not worth it. If it was a newer truck, I definitely would do it the correct way. But this is a functional way. We'll get you back on the road quick. So here we go. Okay, I flipped the back seat forward. The fuel pump is basically right in this area right here. So all you need to do, these covers, they just pop right off. No tools required. We're going to remove these four nuts. There's one there, one back here by the seat belt, and one right underneath there. So we're going to remove those four, pull this seat out, just flop it in the back. The carpet seamed right there, which is nice. And I'll probably pop this trim out as well. Flip the carpet forward and backwards and we'll have access to the whole floorboard area. There's some spot welds on the floor that's a great reference point to measure off of to make the access window to the fuel pump. The access area is going to be about 6 inches deep by about 9 inches wide. Okay, here we go. Okay, so you're going to get to a point where you have to get to those guys down underneath there. And you got this stupid thing in the way, right? And you'll be pulling on it like trying to figure out how to get it off. It's actually held on with two little metal clips. So just grab it and give it a big yank and it'll pop right out. Okay, so there's the clips. One there and one there. And you go in that slot. That's locked. So that's out of your way. Now you got nice easy access to those nuts. Easy peasy. Failed to mention is there's two bolts underneath this bracket. There's a bracket that the seat belts connect to that goes between the larger rear seat and the smaller rear seat. It's this bracket here. It's kind of U-shaped. There's two bolts. There's one right down here where my middle finger is, and there's one back here. Those two need to come out to separate this larger back seat from the smaller back seat. It's a bear to deal with both of these connected as one unit because it's actually pretty bulky and klutzy, but just one seat by itself is not too bad. Okay, once you get the back seat loose, this is what you got left. So there was five main mounting points. One, two, three. That one over there that held the seat belt, and that one right there. So there's five nuts, two bolts. Those two bolts were the ones that were right in this area. And I just flipped the seat into the back. So now we're ready to pop this out and pull this carpet apart, and we'll be ready to make our hole right there. Okay, carpet is folded back, held in place. Basically, you'll see these rivets, right? There's rivets on both sides. There's rivets running down here, rivets running this way, and that's your reference. You'll want to stay just inside these rivets. Cut a straight line up to the edge, straight down, and you really only need to go, I usually go just a little bit between these two ribs. Some people cut right on the top of this rib, and I don't like that. I prefer to go more in the middle. But if you cut this box out, just like so, I'm going to tape it off so you have a little better reference. your lid or your access point to your fuel pump's right there. Okay, here we go. Okay, there's the area taped off that we will be cutting out. So I'm gonna rig up the GoPro and capture that action. Okay, folks, I opted not to cut it across here. I just folded it open like a door. It's just one less seam you have to repair when you're done. But there's where it lines up right after you cut it. So now we got to remove this ring, undo the fuel fittings, the two electrical connectors, pop her right out. I got the fuel lines off. To remove them, you squeeze these guys, and that'll allow you to slide them off. The black part will come off. Sorry, the black part will come off. This clip will stay on here, and to get them off, you just stick a screwdriver inside the little flap that's keeping it locked to this lip, and they'll pop right off. And you can plug them back in. They're reusable. Electrical connectors are undone. This ring is crazy rusty. But what it needs to do is these posts stay. They're part of the gas tank. This ring will spin, releasing this ring, and then this whole thing will pop out. But they have this little tab here, right? All you do is stick a screwdriver in here, open that tab, to do it one-handed, and then stick a coin in there to keep it open. A nickel purse, anything. So just go like that, and that'll keep that little tab from engaging that ring. You can see the slot that this is supposed to go into when I pound this ring counterclockwise. Okay, here we go. Okay, so this ring ended up being so incredibly rusty that it's just crumbling. It looks like the tank is perfectly fine, but this ring is just nasty. And you can't do anything to cut it off that'll create sparks. So I've just been soaking it with penetrating oil and prying on it. And I've got it somewhat freed up now. You can see it wiggles. Worst case is if I can't get it to spin, I'm just going to drill a few holes in it and break it apart. But you can't just get on it with a cutting wheel or anything like that. You gotta be very careful not to generate sparks because you are dealing with fuel. Well, after enough beating and prying on it, you can see I got it loose. It is free of the gas tank. The gas tank tabs are okay. It's just this ring just totally rusted out. I'm gonna carefully clean this up a little bit before I remove it. I don't want all that junk going in my tank. I did pick up a brand new ring though. The O-ring came with the pump. So there we go, ready to go. Okay, we got her all vacuumed out nice and clean. And now basically we just lift this old pump up out of here. Like so. Looks nice and clean down inside. I'm just gonna wipe out that rim and put the new pump in. Okay, I got the new pump already. Got the float on for the fuel level sensor. There's the O-ring. There's the top, and it's ready to go in. Okay, the new pump is in. The new lock ring is spun around and engaged with this little tab to keep it from undoing itself, which I find very unlikely, provided how difficult it was to get it on. The new pump comes with a new connector. So this is the connector off the OEM original. There's a new connector that comes with it to plug into there. It's a very simple wire-for-wire splice. The colors and everything are correct on the new harness. So I'll take care of that, get that buttoned up, and then I'll put this back together, and we'll fire it up. All right, to cap off the repair, I used a license plate from an old radio station
to reinforce the floor. I screwed it on each side of the seam, and it's pretty much as rigid as ever. I'm going to tape up these seams with a metalized duct tape, and that's it. Truck fires right up, everything worked perfect. Okay, folks, that wraps her up. As you can see, everything's back together. The carpet's tucked back in nicely. Never even knew it happened. If you found this video remotely useful, please like and subscribe. Thank you very much. Have a great day. Thanks for watching.